When did this happen? I didn't say anything about it. I didn't agree to that. No. That's, you're basically at the receiving end. Okay, you wake up in the morning. Okay. There will be that interest that you have to pay, late fee, whatever. You're always in the side of what? Reactive side, not proactive. You're just reacting. Because you're a minority, you don't have a say. Now, who controls the scene? The people who do not want Islam. And I mean by Islam, they do not want the culture of religion. I decided to call them, and alhamdulillah, ikhwa, I authored a book, is about to be released, inshallah, Journey Through Juz'a Amma. I called them in the book the status co-brokers. Who are the status co-brokers? The people who benefit from the absence of religion. They benefit. Now, they will take some of their money and reinvest it to make sure what? That religion is what? Sidelined. Whether by demonizing us or whether by creating that Islamophobic culture, making people fear Islam, and so forth. And they will use every tool they have. And the most effective tool is education. That's why the education system here is based on what? The separation between what? We can say masjid. You don't have to say a church. Do you go to church? No. The separation between masjid and? Imagine you send your child to the public school system for what? How many years? 12 years? To learn that there is no God. Or at least there are multiple. They will use media. How often do you hear the media talk about Allah, about God? When there is a storm, what they say? Mother Nature. Well, listen, there are three, we call them, ya ikhwa, markaziyatul wahy, concentrics of the revelation, that they don't want them. Number one, Allah, God, the existence of a creator. They want to remove this completely from the equation. But it's hard because a lot of people have what? The fitra, this is extremely difficult. Now what they do, they distorted. They give him human attributes. Oh, God is an astaghfirullah. They will say, nice, he's white. They depict him in a certain way. Or in Islam, we have those people actually who mess around with the names and the attributes in order for you not to connect with Allah properly. They tell you, you can't say Allah has this or has that. They negate the attributes. Two, no religion. And normally no religion, they bring it to you under the idol of what? Liberty, freedom. Are you liberal? Come on, you wanna follow religion that, are you really serious about this? Aren't you liberal? And they make idols for this. You know, when you land in New York, what is the first idol that you come across? Statue of Liberty. Statue of Liberty. What is liberty? There is one concept for you as a Muslim. If you miss, I'm sorry, you're in trouble. That you're a slave to Allah. أنت عبد لله. Allah tells you what He wants from you. And you're supposed to say what? سمعنا وأطعنا. Now they tell you, and look how they go after our woman, huh? When they wear, what happened there? Let's liberate the Muslim women. Yani when they went and invaded Afghanistan, I remember that time. One of the first achievements that they announced that we're going to have for the first time in history, Miss Afghanistan joining the pageant, you know, that the beauty, whatever. And they had her walk, you know how they walk the, I don't look at the picture, but you know how they walk, huh? It's amazing. This is the best achievement. Why? Yes. They don't want religion. And here is the interesting piece. Imagine you go to a university, a college, and then the professor comes in and he says, guys, my dear students, no curriculum. You choose your own what? You choose what you want to study. What do you think about this guy? Huh? And guess what? No finals. No exam. خلاص. No day of judgment. That's the third one. No day of judgment. So you're going to live your life what? You're going to live large. I mean, there is no curriculum. I could introduce my own. Like some people, they come up with their own religion, right? Some people every day, they invent what? Their own religion, and they say they worship Allah. And no accountability, no day of judgment. That's great. What would you say about this institution that does this? Lack of what? Wisdom. I want you to go back and trace the Quran. Who can translate the following? وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. How do you translate it? Say?
Didn't give Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his right?
Very close. Anyone else? وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. They have not given Allah his due respect, reverence. This, it's a portion of a verse, by the way, was repeated in the Quran in three places. Just three places, and each one of them with one of those. One with Allah, one with the deen, and one with the day of judgment. Let's follow the order of the Mus'haf. The first one that came in the Mus'haf, Surah Al-An'am. وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ إِذْ قَالُوا مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَى بَشَرٍ مِّن شَيْءٍ. They said Allah never reveals books. That means what? No religion. There is no wahy. That means what? No religion. Look at the second one. Surah Al-Hajj, about Allah. But it came after the verse, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ ضُرِبَ مَثَلٌ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ. Allah has set a parable for you, a similitude. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ لَنْ يَخْلُقُوا ذُبَابًا وَلَوْ اجْتَمَعُوا لَهُ. Those you call upon beside Allah, they will not be able to create a fly, even if they gather. وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِ. Right after this verse. The third about the day of judgment. Surah Az-Zumar. وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ وَالْأَرْضُ جَمِيعًا قَبْضَتُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَالسَّمَاوَاتُ مَطْوِيَّاتٌ بِيَمِينِهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. Why is this? Because when you say that there is no accountability, there is no day of judgment, you're now questioning Allah's wisdom. So why did Allah make us then? Well, there is a verse at the end of Surah Al-Mu'minun. It says what? أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا وأنكم إلينا لا ترجعون. Do you think that we created you for no purpose? Is that something that you say about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? No. The status quo brokers, they work hard in order to keep the religion away because the religion for them is a threat. And when I say the religion, the belief in Allah, the belief that there is a guidance by which you should conduct your lives, and you believe there will be a reward or a punishment for your choices. But the cornerstone of all of this is Sa'a, the day of judgment. That is the key, that you believe that there, after death, there will be accountability. Look how the first surah in the Quran begins. Imagine this. You enter Juz' Amma, huh? And then you look from above the wall. Well, every surah has a wall. You look behind, what do you see? Assemblies, buckets of people sitting together and staring up questions about the day of judgment. Amma, what? Yatasa'alun. عن النبأ العظيم الذي هم فيه مختلفون. They are not asking questions, by the way, to learn. You see, if they are asking questions to learn, Allah would have said what? عما يسألون. But yet, هذا إيه بسموه مفاعلة, that you're making up the question in order to make you doubt. Do you really believe that there is a day of judgment? Huh? Do you really believe that? That's called what? I'm trying to stir doubt, provoke doubt on him. And you see, this particular subject, you can't even question it. You cannot question it. Because this is a belief matter, a matter of aqeedah is already settled. I believe that there is a day of judgment, and that's why I look this way. That's why I decided to live my life this way. That's why I decided to embrace this path. I'm not like John and Patricia or whoever they are out there going to the club tonight. I decided to come and stay with you today because that's the life that I chose. So I'm building, conducting my life based on the belief in Akhirah. Now you want me to go back and reassess this? No. You can't be doing that. And that's what those people do. They get Muslims or those people to question. In Surah As-Saffat, Ya Ikhwa, there is a very interesting conversation between the people of hellfire. The people of Jannah. One of them will say, Inni kana li qareen. I used to have a friend in the dunya, someone I hang around with, and he used to tell me the following. يَقُولُ أَإِنَّكَ لَمِنَ الْمُصَدِّقِينَ. Do you truly believe that? أَإِذَا مِتْنَا وَكُنَّا تُرَابًا وَعِظَامًا أَإِنَّا لَمَدِينُونَ. Do you truly believe that after we die and we become bones and dust, we're going to be raised up to be held accountable again? Then he said to the people of Jannah with him, قال هل أنتم مطلعون. Can we look and see if we can see him in hell? فطلع فرآه في سواء الجحيم. They looked up and they found him what? In the middle of the hellfire. So he called upon him. He said to him, having I heard you, I would have been with you there with you. The important thing is the status quo brokers, their job is to use all the tools, media, TV, education, forums, whatever it is, social media, just to spread the culture of what? No religion, no God, no day of judgment. No day of judgment. Now, you will find a weak segment in the society listen to them. And they endorse their what? Their ideology. But on the other hand, you got the strangers, which I decided to call them the da'wah champions. The people who resist that. No, there is a day of judgment. And subhanAllah, ya ikhwa, I mentioned this a couple of times, that you as a believer in the hereafter, don't entertain a status quo who's trying to make you doubt any of the religion. And I always use this example, Al-As ibn Wa'il al-Sahmi, one of the status quo brokers. He was one of the chiefs of Quraysh, the father of Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, the one who brought Islam to Egypt. One day he brought decayed bones, old bones, to the Prophet. And he said, what to him? You want to tell me that after we, and he smashed the bones, like, after we become like this, Allah is going to raise us again? You know how the Prophet responded to him? He's trying to make the Prophet what? Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, what? Doubt. He said, يَبْعَثُكَ, he will raise you up. ثُمَّ يُدْخِلُكَ النَّارِ وَيُعَذِّبُكَ فِيهِ. Then he will admit you into hell and he will burn you there. You have to deflect this way. You have to. You can be what? You can be apologetic. Of course, I'm talking about someone you know. He's trying to do what to you? But if someone who's, you know, one of the weak segments who was swayed by these campaigns, the status quo, are give him da'wah, there is nothing. You don't have to be mean to him. But I'm talking about what? Someone who's trying to do what? And I given the brothers the example that should be the authority of the leader of the Muslim community. That you shouldn't allow these campaigns to go around the people. As a leader, you shouldn't. And I shared with them a story which I researched, and it's authentic. A man who used to live in Al-Kufa, in Al-Basra, in Iraq. His name is Sabigh ibn Itl. Sabigh used to go around the people and stir up these. He would question mutashabih al-Quran, the unclear of the Quran. He would go and ask, what is the meaning of النازعات غرقا? What is النازعات غرقا? What does it mean, المرسلات عرفا? Only really learned people would know what they mean. So he would go and ask. Now, Amir al-Basra sent to Umar because that was his pattern all the time. He never asked about something that is what? And he just asked the questions. He's not interested in receiving answers or any of that. Fa'umar sent to him immediately. As soon as he arrived Medina, he started what? Punishing him. I know a lot of you would say, why would Umar do that? Someone who's trying what? But Umar understood what he's doing. He's trying to stir up doubt about the Quran. He looked at Umar and he said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, O Commander of the Faithful, إذا أردت قتلي فاقتلني. If you want to kill me, go ahead and kill me. And if you want to cure me, فوالله, by Allah, I'm cured. Without even having a conversation, he understood why Umar is punishing him. He said, I'm cured. I'll never go back to this again. I'll never do this again. What I'm trying to say here is it should be the community, the Muslim community should not be left to people who go around and what? explain the, some people who say that worshiping the graves is not shirk. The Quran has a hole in the narrative, and the other one says you can pray to this, and the other one says you. What? No. The Sultan should be what? You see, you can have that liberty questioning the aqaid, the beliefs of people. Surah An-Naba begins with the scene, and the entire juz, the entire 30 juz of the Quran is based on this. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling those who question the day of judgment, the accountability, that there will be a punishment and there will be a reward. كَلَّا سَيَعْلَمُونَ. They will find out. ثُمَّ كَلَّا سَيَعْلَمُونَ. And then they will find out. The scholar said they will find out at the time of death. The first one. And the second, they will find out when they are raised up. طب, what is the next surah in جزء النبأ? النازعات. What is the first scene in Surah An-Nazi'at? The first scene. People dying. Two individuals dying. One of them is being punished. This is the one who denied resurrection. This is the one who did not believe. وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقًا. The angels, when they extract his soul, they take it out forcefully. Because based on Hadith al-Bara ibn Azib radiyallahu anhuma, that when the angels descend, they have a shroud from hell, and they have some other items from hell, and their faces are what? Scary. So as soon as the person who's about to die sees them, his soul will run away inside what? فَتَفْرَقُ رُوحُهُ فِي جَسَدِهِ. Now for him, they have to beat him up in order to forcefully extract that soul out of the body. On the other hand, the second scene, وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَةً. Nashitat is those who take out gently the soul of a believer. Subhanallah. Look at the first scene in Surah An-Nazi'at. And again, I want to emphasize this. The one story mentioned in Surah An-Nazi'at is the story of who? Musa and Fir'aun. Why Fir'aun? Fir'aun was a status quo broker. You agree? Guess what? He killed the children. He killed the newborn boys in order what? To maintain what? His authority and his power. He was afraid of them because he was told that a boy will be born and he will be the cause of the destruction of his kinship. That's why he decided to slaughter them. So obviously he was a denier of resurrection. He actually claimed to be what? Now, what did he do at the time of death? What did he do? Didn't he believe when it's too late? حتى إذا أدركه الغرق قال آمنت. I believe in the God that Bani Israel. الآن, no, it's too late. After seeing the angels, you can. We know that Jibril, he saw Jibril. Jibril would put what, based on the hadith, would put what in his mouth? In order not to repent, in order not to say it. He said it after time. We call it when the unseen becomes what? Seen to you. That's when tawbah is no longer accepted. But again, the surah tells you what? Look at this. Surah An-Nazi'at ends with what? With the continuous campaign of stating doubt, questioning the day of judgment. What is the last set of verses in Surah An-Nazi'at? What? يسألونك عن الساعة أيان مرساه. Now you move to Surah Abasa. This is, by the way, the style of tafsir that I'm doing is called the maqasidic tafsir, that you look at the overall surah and you just produce the higher aim and you give it a context. Surah, what is the surah next after Al-Nazi'at? Amma, then what? Al-Nazi'at, then what? Abasa. In that surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the da'wah champions, you and me, through addressing Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because one of the strategies of the status quo brokers is to absorb and waste your resources. They engage you in debates. They are not going to believe. Their job is not to believe. They already settled. But their job is what? Is to engage you in order to waste your time, waste your energy. Allah is telling us, don't do that. Based on what did I say that? The situation. Abdullah ibn Maktoum, the blind, came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam while the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was engaged with who? With the status quo brokers. And they are negotiating with him. Imagine one of the conditions they had, that they don't want to sit with these poor Muslims or what? We're special. So we want us. The Prophet said no. Allah is telling Rasulullah, no, don't do this. Of course, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we need to understand also that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was trying to do this to bring some relief, because at this stage, the Muslims were going through persecution. When these leaders accept Islam, obviously, they will gain some ground. We know the difference that someone like Umar, the difference he made, at least the da'wah moved from the secrecy, from the stage of being in private, to what? To public, because of Umar and Hamza radiallahu anhum. But again, أَمَّا مَنِ اسْتَغْنَى فَأَنْتَ لَهُ تَصَدَّ. The one who feels he doesn't want Islam, he is not interested in Islam, you go and you what? وَأَمَّا مَنْ جَاءَكَ يَسْعَى وَهُوَ يَخْشَى فَأَنْتَ عَنْهُ كَلَّا. Don't do this again. But again, يا إخوة, يعني الكلام لك وافهمي يا جارة. Always when you see stuff like this with Rasulullah, we're really being addressed by that. And you're going to find this. You're going to find a lot of young du'at, when they engage in the field of da'wah, the first thing they do is what? Debate. They go into what? Debate. And debate who? Individuals who are, they are actually making a living from their misguidance. One of the most dangerous or damaging things to you is when, you know, someone is making a living from his religious whatever. That's when, if you take it away from him, that means what? That's why we shouldn't associate this with this. I think Maghrib is approaching. But let me give you that piece. The next set of four four surahs, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in an authentic hadith, which is in Sahih al-Bukhari, hadith Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu anhuma, if you want to look at the day of judgment like you see it with your own eyes, read the following three chapters. What are these three chapters? إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ. Two, إذا السماء انفطرت. 3 إذا السماء انشقت. سورة التكوير، سورة الانفطار، سورة الانشقاق. Just read the introductory verses. What happens? The stars, the sun, the moon, the earth split as if you see it. Inshallah, we will stop here. I think Maghrib is coming, right?
5 minutes, 6 minutes.
6 more minutes. MashaAllah. Assalamu alaikum. Ta'ala, Sheikh Osman, ta'ala. Ta'ala, Rajil. Ta'ala. تعالى وحشنا والله. قلت شيخ عثمان مش فين الشيخ ابراهيم؟ ما تيجي يا شيخ ابراهيم تعالى. لا 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 في 3 كراسي هم. لا 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 في 3 كراسي. تعالى يا شيخ عثمان تفضل. الحمد لله تفضل تفضل. تعالى يا شيخ ابراهيم. تفضل شيخ. ف لايك لايك وي منشن يا اخوه جزء عما از اباوت ميكين يو ميك ا ديسيجن فورسينج يو تو ميك ا ديسيجن. The verses are straight to the point, very sharp, very sharp. That's Muawiyah for you. Muawiyah, sit, come on, sit with us. And it leads you to make a decision, which path you're going to take. Inshallah, hopefully, we will understand and engage in Juz' al-Naba, inshallah, Juz' al-Amma. It's a beautiful, ya ikhwa, Juz', a lot of you memorize its verses, its surahs. You hear it always recited in the salah by the imams. You recite a lot of it. A lot of young ones, particularly, they memorize it. So why didn't you make a move and try to understand it? You know, and it's not hard. I found out it's not hard. It's really easy to understand. But let me ask you a question. How many segments in the society we live in now? Can you name these segments? But not the brothers who've been here, Fajr and the new brothers. What is the first segment in the society? Those who control the scene. What do you call? What did we call them? What? Status quo brokers. We call them the status quo brokers. That would be the leaders, the head, the education department, the Trump, whoever it is, the people who are what? Who make the calls. What is the second? The weak segment who hear and who are influenced. There is a segment in the society who are influenced by them. And there is a debate between the two on the day of judgment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala depicted for us in Surah Saba. وَلَوْ تَرَى إِذِ الظَّالِمُونَ مَوْقُوفُونَ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ يَرْجِعُ بَعْضُهُمْ إِلَى بَعْضٍ الْقَوْلَ. So both groups will be in hell. The status quo and the weak influence segment. So the weak influence will say to the status quo, لَوْلَا أَنْتُمْ لَكُنَّا مُؤْمِنِينَ. Has it been for you? Would have been what? Believers. قال الذين استكبروا. The status quo will say back to them, أنحن صددناكم عن الهدى بعد إذ جاءكم؟ Do you truly believe that? Did we like, you know, like, did we beat you up? بل كنتم مجرمين. You were transgressors to begin with. You wanted that. You wanted that. Look how they will respond. They will say, بل مكر الليل والنهار. You didn't do it right. You didn't beat us up. But you kept what? Plotting. Plotting in the education, in this, in that. The plotting. Yeah, they don't come to you straightforward and this is the second segment. The third segment in the society which we ask Allah that we belong to it, which is what? The strangers. You can call it the strangers or the da'wah champion. Those are the three segments. You're going to find them throughout juz' عما يتساءلون. بارك الله فيكم. جزاكم الله خيرا. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك. نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت. أستغفرك ونتوب إليك. والحمد لله رب العالمين.